I hope that all of you are doing well right now, keeping safe. They're rough out in the real world right now. Some important conversations are indeed happening, but just a lot of chaos. And truly, 2020 has been all around crazy, a year none of us will ever forget. And hey, we're not even halfway through the year yet. Who knows what's in store ahead? Anyway, as most of you know, this video game industry is coming together, putting their support behind the Black Lives Matter movement, some in bigger ways than others. We've seen multiple gaming events being delayed, like the PlayStation 5 gameplay event. Rockstar Games took their online servers offline for 2 hours the other day during the George Floyd Memorial to show their respect. Multiple gaming companies such as Square Enix have made donations, and obviously by now you've seen the usual brand statement, raising awareness, yes, which for the most part though has been mocked by much of the internet. And that's actually one of the big main topics that we're going to be hitting on today, and that is insincere hypocrisy that has been called out by many on social media, specifically Bethesda, Electronic Arts, and Activision Blizzard. They've been slammed. But yeah, even during these chaotic times, we still have gaming companies being the absolute worst, like Rockstar's parent company Take-Two Interactive canceling its contract with the then struggling Star Theory Games, and then Take-Two trying to poach its entire team. Truly just bizarre. Take-Two was negotiating with the executives of the indie game studio that they tasked with developing Kerbal Space Program 2. Negotiations were over royalty terms and potential acquisition of the small game studio, but abruptly negotiations were killed. Take-Two severed ties, and then Take-Two formed a new studio and asked all the employees of Star Theory to come join Take-Two and continue work on the game with them. Just completely evil, and honestly, much of this games industry values money and nothing else. They don't care about doing the right thing or social causes. They donate because they feel an obligation, and/or they need some good PR. But yeah, besides the hypocrisy of this games industry, we're also going to be diving into outrage coming via Canada over Cyberpunk 2077's more adult content, Ubisoft's strange lie over a monetization feature, and Sony claiming that The Last of Us Part 2 has not suffered any damage due to the past few weeks of negative PR, largely associated with the game's massive story leaks. We have that and more, but as usual, if you do go on to enjoy this content and want to show your support for content like this, please consider hitting that like button, subscribing for more, and turning notifications on so you do not miss out on any new videos. Also, it's now been 1 month since my Patreon went live. A big shout out to all of those who have contributed thus far, and if you want to help out the channel further with financial backing and gain some benefits like deciding certain upcoming videos, become a patron today. As always, links are down in the description below. Nonetheless, to our first topic of the day, and that is Ubisoft pulling an EA. So the thing is about this AAA games industry, a lot of companies just make mind-boggling decisions or statements that, well, they look pretty much exactly what you expect from Electronic Arts, and even Ubisoft has ironically mocked EA for some of this stuff in the past, like the sense of pride and accomplishment. I believe there was a quest in Assassin's Creed Odyssey that mocked that, but here we are. So we have this article coming from PC Gamer. Ubisoft says Trackmania is not subscription-based, you just pay for it multiple times, so subscription. Anyway, the story says Ubisoft announced a somewhat unusual pricing scheme for the upcoming Trackmania Nations reboot last week. The base game will be free, but full access to the track editor, which is the main appeal, costs $10 per year, while full-on club access, which includes admission to special racing leagues, exclusive skins, and that sort of thing, is $30 per year. And as you might expect, a lot of people were very unhappy about this, as some people just want to own the complete product, and they didn't want a subscription-based pricing model for this. So Ubisoft actually came out with a statement saying, actually, it's not a subscription model, but an access to the game for a limited time. You pay for having access to the game for one period, and that's it. A Ubisoft rep wrote, when the time is over, you have to buy the game again for the time that you want access to. It's a subscription. And that's what PC Gamer says. It's a very creative way of calling it a subscription without calling it a subscription. And predictably, it has not smoothed the waters, and many Redditors are now pointing out that this is very similar to EA's description of loot boxes, in which EA calls it surprise mechanics, which it's not. It's loot boxes. And the same thing here, it's a subscription. And that actually leads to Ubisoft's statement about this, because they have responded to some of the anger about this, and they have admitted, well, the managing director behind the game has says it is in fact subscription-based, but added that it's not the point. well, it is the point, it's subscription. And he goes on about the value, which what they're trying to give to consumers, and then by the end it says, as for why a Ubisoft rep said that the new Trackmania doesn't use a subscription model, the managing director said it was an answer written by someone of the studio to another player question in the 14th page of a forum on a given minute of the day. Welcome to the internet. Well, at the same time, maybe a Ubisoft rep shouldn't be giving out false answers like this. Anyway, this is just very strange. I don't really understand why Ubisoft couldn't be transparent and honest here. But then again, I say this almost all the times whenever any of these AAA games companies acts just moronic, I guess that's the best way to describe it. Like, CD Projekt Red for many is seen as the gold standard. They are honest and transparent about almost everything. But a lot of these gaming companies, like EA with the loot boxes, not calling it what it actually is, calling it surprise mechanics, it doesn't make any sense because nobody believes it, but yet they lie. And here, Ubisoft, I don't get why a Ubisoft rep even gave an answer if he was going to lie. Like I said, just very strange, but it's great that the managing director did reach out and explain a little bit and trying to say that they are giving value to their players. But again, if it's a subscription, just call it a subscription. Now to our next topic, and this is probably the bigger one that's going on throughout this video game industry right now, and this is the gaming industry backing the Black Lives Matter movement, and a lot of companies have been contributing in their own ways. You've seen the statements, you've seen various companies donating, and a lot of companies vowing to do better. But some of these gaming companies have come under fire because of their past history with certain decisions which kind of go against what they're actually saying right now. So what do I mean by that? Well, we'll first start with Electronic Arts. On their EA Madden NFL Twitter or social media accounts, they announced that they would be delaying or they would not be celebrating at this time the Madden NFL 21 event that they had planned, and they were doing this because they want attention to be on the issues that are being discussed right now here in the United States. They wanted awareness to be on that and not them. This was something that was met to a lot of people they were okay and happy by this, but some people pointed out kind of the hypocrisy with EA because of some of the past decisions that the company has made. And what do I mean by that? Well, as one tweet went viral, people said, "Ain't this you?" Colin Kaepernick's name censored from song on Madden NFL 19 soundtrack. And if you're unaware by this, EA at the time actually did release a statement apologizing. They said it was an unfortunate mistake that they made. They said, "We messed up and the edit should not have happened." And they said they would make it right, and they did. They updated it to Madden NFL 19. But the thing is, the year prior, they actually did the same exact thing. This was something pointed out in this article coming from TechCrunch. NBC Sports notes, however, this is apparently not the first time Kaepernick's name has been removed from a Madden soundtrack. While the player's likeness appeared in the last year's version of the game, his name was apparently also removed from the Mike Will Made It track Bars of Soap. So what I'm trying to hit at, maybe EA does care. We know how they are with social issues, but the company certainly values money over everything, like this whole entertainment industry, or all companies in the world. So that's really why a lot of people have been saying that Electronic Arts is being pretty hypocritical here, because, yeah, like any company in this industry, their social justice gets to a point where, well, they're gonna stop that because money, and I mean, that's just how everything works in this world, unfortunately. Now, it's worth mentioning that EA they've lended more support than most companies. They're donating quite a bit of money, they're starting discussion at their company, and this has been met to a lot of positivity from individuals who have actually interacted with this announcement. But do they actually mean it? I honestly have no idea. I'm sure a lot of employees, a lot of people that work in their offices do believe and support these causes, but as a company, the executives at top, the only thing that I know that they value is money, and we've seen the greed and the hypocrisy over the years, and you make of that as you wish. But one company where it's just very strange that they're now taking this stance is Activision Blizzard. A lot of people were shocked by this, and honestly, I wasn't sure if they were even going to put a statement because of their past history with the whole Blitzchung Hong Kong situation. But Activision Blizzard started on May 31st with this statement. "Today and always, we support all those who stand against racism and inequality. There's no place for it in our society or any society. Black lives matter." Now, the issue with this is the company's stance on political issues or really anything that is controversial, like China. Anything China, Activision Blizzard steers away because of that market and they do not want to lose on it because, again, money. Now, as the Actman, actually, one YouTuber that I love following, he pointed out it's ironic because Activision Blizzard's CEO said, "Our gaming platform is not the place for political views," when he was asked about the whole Hong Kong and Blitzchung situation. But the thing is, some people have responded back saying that this isn't a political statement, this is about human decency, but then again, the people in Hong Kong, that's all they're fighting for, human rights and human decency, so you make of that as you wish, but I do think it is extremely hypocritical for Activision Blizzard to get right in there right now with this stance just because they wouldn't even acknowledge Hong Kong in any of their statements, anything that Blizzard said, they did not mention anything to do with Hong Kong because they know that could upset the Chinese government. We already know how on their official channels in China they responded, which was pretty much condemning what Blitzchung had said. Now, if you didn't follow that whole ordeal or don't know about Blitzchung, I guess a basic small summary is that he was a Hearthstone esports player and he was banned for supporting the Hong Kong protesters during an official live stream in late 2019. He had specifically said, "Liberate Hong Kong, revolution of our age," and Blizzard was not having it. They banned him and even the broadcasters that had interviewed him. And on Chinese social media, they kind of celebrated this decision. And in the eyes of many, it was seen as Blizzard pretty much giving their support to the oppressive human rights breaking China government because money, and that's what it's always about, people. It's always money. And the hypocrisy is that Blitzchung was, well, he was giving his support to the protesters who were fighting for their rights, fighting for human rights, human decency. Now, this response, the whole situation eventually led to the United States government, various politicians like AOC and Ted Cruz, bipartisan support, pretty much condemning Blizzard for what they had done. One senator, Ron Wyden, had said, "Blizzard showed it is willing to humiliate itself to please the Chinese Communist Party." There was also protests within Blizzard in which employees staged a walkout because a lot of them were very unhappy with how Blizzard approached and responded to this situation. And what followed was Blizzard officially giving out a couple of responses. They reduced the suspensions or the punishment that was given to Blitzchung and the broadcasters, but a lot of people just felt like it wasn't enough. And eventually there was another response in which J. Allen Brack, the president at Blizzard, apologized, but even then a lot of people felt it was a non-apology. And at the end of the day, Blizzard just never really addressed the Hong Kong protests. They didn't even mention any of that because they wanted to avoid that, because again, that Chinese market is everything to various gaming publishers in this industry, and they do not want to miss out on that, and them talking about Hong Kong protests and that situation means money could be gone. So at the end of the day, Blizzard's whole response to that situation was seen as pathetic, and even to this day a lot of people are very upset with Blizzard and many just don't want anything to do with their products anymore. It is worth mentioning, this is something that keeps being brought up, but it's the CEO of Activision Blizzard, Bobby Kotick's comments, which he made in late 2019, just a number of weeks after this whole Hong Kong situation with Blizzard had blown up, in which he declared that their gaming platform isn't the place for political views, in which that's what he described, somebody giving their support for the Hong Kong protests, in which again, I don't know if that's a political view, but regardless, what he had specifically told CNBC was, "We're not the operator of the world's town halls, turning to business leaders and expecting them to lead on a variety of subjects, including Hong Kong and democracy. We're the operators of the communities that allow you to have fun through the lens of video games. My responsibility is to make sure that our communities feel safe, secure, comfortable, and satisfied and entertained. That doesn't convey to me the right to have a platform for a lot of political views, I don't think. I think my responsibility is to satisfy our audiences and our stakeholders, our employees, our shareholders." So now hopefully you get a better understanding of why a lot of people just don't really understand or believe Activision Blizzard cares about the social causes going on here in the United States, and that's because of what happened just months ago. But it is worth mentioning some of the ways that Activision Blizzard is addressing or giving attention to this situation, the Black Lives Matter movement in the United States. They now have a message which pops up on loading screens and Call of Duty Modern Warfare and Warzone. They also have delayed new seasons of Modern Warfare, Warzone, and Call of Duty Mobile, and they actually postponed the upcoming World of Warcraft Shadowlands livestream, which they had planned for June 9th, but this is a Blizzard post, and you know how a lot of people came to this post like, this is some hypocrisy here. And then there was also an announcement by Infinity Ward that they would be doing a better job of addressing racist and hate-oriented names, and just general behavior which goes on within their games, which I don't know why it took a situation like this to get on top of just some horrific names that I've seen. Like, a lot of people have been posting some usernames and gamer tags, just stuff that shouldn't be allowed, and it's just kind of horrific that it even got past the censors in the game or whatever systems that are supposed to be in place. In other news, Activision Blizzard shareholders are upset over CEO Bobby Kotick's compensation, which, it looks like maybe some people over there in the company are now realizing maybe paying this guy so much money, he's worth like $8 billion at this point, probably not a good idea, especially since the company is missing performance targets right now. And the publisher actually did come to Kotick's defense, obviously. I mean, this is the top guy, this is what's going to happen. But as GamesIndustry.biz reports, Activision Blizzard has come under fire from some of its own shareholders who argued that CEO Bobby Kotick gets paid too much. Two proxy advisory service firms have recommended that Activision Blizzard shareholders vote against a proposal to remunerate Kotick in line with previous years. The recommendation was supported by the CTW Investment Group, which works to hold directors accountable for irresponsible and unethical corporate behavior and excessive executive pay. Well, that defines much of this gaming industry. And as one of the directors says, despite repeated low approval votes from shareholders, Activision Blizzard maintains multiple overlapping opportunities for its CEO to earn outsized equity awards, even when performance-related vesting thresholds have not been met, reads the filing. And the director continues, saying that Kotick's current remuneration is of special concern given the uncertainty faced by Activision Blizzard staff following its decision to lay off 800 staff in early 2019. Despite a record year. You remember that? I remember that. That's actually kind of funny that shareholders are actually now upset about that and bringing that up. Like, hey, maybe this guy who fired 800 people and he makes so much money, maybe he's the problem? I just kind of find that funny. But Activision Blizzard did release a statement to GameSpot in which they just bring up all of the highlights in Kotick's career, which, whatever. They say during Kotick's tenure, which is the longest of any CEO of a public technology company, Activision Blizzard's market capitalization is increased from less than $10 million to over $53 billion. So in a way, Activision Blizzard, or at least the PR department, is trying to come up with a statement that says that he's invaluable and he's worth every single dollar which he's paid, which I think he has a salary of like $30 to $40 million every single year, which still quite a bit of dough right there. Now, moving along to our next story, this is actually another response coming from a gaming industry figure responding to the current Black Lives Matter movement going on in the United States, and this was Randy Pitchford, somebody who is... I can't even keep a straight face. This guy is quite something. Responsible for Borderlands, and he's also a magician who left a USB with adult content and company secrets at a restaurant, which ended up getting discovered, which was also not password protected. That's my favorite Randy Pitchford story. But the Gearbox CEO ended up stirring up a lot of drama, and this is an article coming from Game Revolution. Randy Pitchford uses George Floyd tragedy to sell Duke Nukem 3D, doesn't even discount the game. And these are some now deleted tweets coming from Randy Pitchford. If you want to do that to some pig cops this weekend, here's the Duke Nukem 3D 20th Anniversary World Tour, in which he just links the Steam, which this guy is... I don't need to describe how horrible of a human being that Randy Pitchford makes himself out to be, but this is just... This guy just loves controversy, and even this, there's a reason why he deleted this very, very fast. Now, he followed this up with some other tweets saying, "Too provocative? That's the challenge with artists. Sometimes they push boundaries. Even video game developers in 1996. And then he followed again saying, "We're all looking at this world and struggling to come to grips with it. My intent is not to hurt anyone." Well, that first tweet didn't really sound like that, did it? "But I noticed this, and it's interesting that the theme was there over 20 years ago in this video game and feels relevant today. Was feeling cute, may delete later," and he did delete. Which, just, Randy Pitchford just loves controversy and doing dumb things, and this is another example of Randy Pitchford doing something very dumb, and I don't understand this guy. I really don't. He's just kind of crazy, gotta be honest, just kind of crazy, and also, this rhetoric coming from him is kind of dangerous, people. And also, this is my very PG trying to appease YouTube's monetization system of saying that Randy Pitchford, he's a pretty big piece of crap, if you didn't already know that. But even before then, you probably should have known that. Anyway, next we have is Bethesda. Now, Bethesda has had some recent backlash associated with Fallout 76, which has kind of been this has been going on since 2018, really, and it just never stops, but I think people have just grown tired of it. Like, a lot of people are upset with the current state of the game, some of the time gates, and just the overall quality of the product. Like, Bethesda had to recently delay one of their big events just, I believe, hours before it was supposed to go live because it was a buggy mess, and many in the community were absolutely pissed about this. Some going a lot further than others, but on the Fallout 76 subreddit, which is actually very, very supportive of Bethesda, they were lashing out at the company. But regardless, they ended up fixing it, and I think it's all, you know, everything's great now again, until Bethesda screws up the game. They will again, soon. But regardless, Bethesda has been called out on social media because of this. Now, these tweets have been going viral, and people have been pointing out why Brand's virtual signaling is just empty BS. And as you can see, Bethesda, it is Pride Month, and they are supporting it on all of their social media accounts except Turkey, Russia, and the Middle East. You know why? Because those countries don't support Pride or any of that. And these companies, that's as far as their social justice will go, because they want to make sure they can still sell their games and make money in those territories. But if those countries don't support stuff like Pride or Black Lives Matter or anything to do, any social cause, well, these companies will not support it either. Which, yeah, it is unfortunate, and as I've been saying throughout this video, it is certainly hypocritical. But these companies are always hunting for some good PR, and they get tax relief out of all of these donations and all of the things that they do. And indeed, it is good that they're spreading awareness and bringing attention, but at the end of the day, the executives at the top, what they care about the most, and what they only care about, really, is money. And that's just always going to be how it is. Brands will be brands, and Fallout 76 will be Fallout 76, in which the game is forced to refund just because of how magnificent it is. That's sarcasm, people. By far, one of the most anticipated games entering into 2020 was, or still maybe is for a lot of people, The Last of Us Part 2. For a lot of people, The Last of Us was a game that defined the last generation of consoles. It's considered one of the best narratives ever in gaming history. So a lot of people were excited for The Last of Us Part 2, but in recent weeks, things have kind of turned upside down for Sony and Naughty Dog. See, the thing is, a lot of the key moments, lots of gameplay has leaked due to apparent hackers. That's what Naughty Dog claims, but a lot of people have been skeptical about that because Naughty Dog has a long history of treating employees and workers not that well. So a lot of the rumors and theories was that this was a disgruntled employee, and a lot of people aren't too keen on just taking Sony's word at it. But regardless, The Last of Us Part 2 was a game that a lot of people were looking forward to, but it has been spoiled for many. As we explored in a recent video, one of the voice actors of the game, Troy Baker, who portrays Joel, was very vocal about people spoiling the game against it. He slammed those who were doing that, and he also slammed anyone thinking that the game could be ruined by the leaks. I made a long video on that, check that out if you haven't already. But yeah, Naughty Dog has been under fire for weeks. A lot of people upset with the direction that the company has taken with the game. I'm not going to get into actual spoilers or specifics, but there's a lot of people that feel that Naughty Dog is getting political, and that is something that a lot of people just feel like they're disgracing the characters. This was again something that Troy Baker hit on in his response, saying that how could Naughty Dog disrespect the characters that they created themselves. And let's just say The Last of Us Part 2 has been by far one of the most controversial things in gaming so far this year, and the release is quickly approaching. We're actually just a couple of weeks away, and right now Sony is, I wouldn't say they're doing damage control, but they're very much going out of the way to say that they haven't been damaged, the game hasn't been damaged at all by the leaks. There's a story coming via Eurogamer who says, "Story leaks have not affected The Last of Us Part 2 pre-orders, says Sony. Demand outstrips that of Spider-Man at the same point ahead of launch." Sony has confirmed that despite early leaks spoiling several key plot points of the upcoming The Last of Us Part 2, pre-orders remain healthy. PlayStation CEO Jim Ryan further added in an interview with CNET that in Europe, pre-order demand of the sequel is outstripping that of Marvel's Spider-Man the same point before its launch. "We hope this will be a defining game for this generation," Ryan said, talking about The Last of Us Part 2. And my response to all of this, Sony saying that this hasn't been damaged, the game hasn't been damaged at all by the leaks, what do you expect them to say? The game is just a couple of weeks away, and even if there has been an effect on pre-orders, they're not going to say that. They're going to continue to hype this game up and try to make as much money as they can from this, because again, they are a company and that is their goal. And regardless of what you think about the actual leaks, I think a lot of people that are more casual, they don't follow a lot of the stuff that's going on, and I'm not too sure what the overall opinion or how well this game is going to do. I'm very skeptical on people just saying that automatically The Last of Us Part 2 is going to perform poorly, because I don't really believe that. This is a game that sold strongly back in 2013, I believe that's when it did release, and a sequel, a highly anticipated game getting a sequel, no matter what, it's going to sell a lot of copies. But again, it'll be very interesting to see, because right now, nobody really knows. Now, it is worth mentioning that we have some more statistics coming from Sony. They're claiming that The Last of Us Part 2 outperforms God of War pre-order in Brazil. And this is another announcement coming from PlayStation. I don't know if they're just hyping this up for the heck of it, trying to encourage more sales, or they're just putting it out there saying that this game is going to be massive. We'll have to see. But so far, some of the reviewers that have given their impressions, it is overwhelmingly positive. And these are some of the previews that have been given in recent days. Coming via Push Square, they said The Last of Us 2's firefights are fraught, uncomfortable, fantastic. The violence at this kind of fidelity will make you feel uncomfortable, but that's all according to Naughty Dog's plan. While we can't elaborate further, this game is about hatred and vengeance, it's about obsession, and how the cycle of violence destroys everything it touches. Then a review from GameSpot said it was shockingly ruthless. GamesRadar notes that it has a beautiful world that is filled with death. The Last of Us Part 2 can create such complex emotions, and the short segment I can discuss says a lot, but it's how that plays out over the wider context of the full story that will really leave its mark. It's a game that's going to be discussed for a long time to come, and I certainly believe that will be the case. Whether it's good or bad, who knows at this point. And then Pocket-Lint said, The Last of Us Part 2's initial review. In short, even from just this section, it's clear to see how much effort and love has been poured into the look and the sound of The Last of Us Part 2. It is a cinematic experience that stays with you long after the TV has been switched off. Indeed, if this proves to be the swan song of this console generation, Naughty Dog has seemingly once again given a Sony machine a fitting end. Evening Standard says, from the pacing, the detail in the environments, to the humanizing of your enemies, this game is going to blow you away. And then they also, in their title, said this could be the best game ever made, ? GameSpew says, bigger, better, bolder. And then another review coming from Greg Miller said that, I don't understand how anything else could be Game of the Year. Well, there's still Cyberpunk, Greg. And then TechRadar notes, The Last of Us 2 doesn't seem to simply be a rehash of its predecessor. Instead, it elevates the original formula, adding some small but vital features while keeping the elements that made us fall in love with the original. So again, we'll just have to see. I know a lot of people are very upset with the direction that Naughty Dog has taken, and we'll have to see if that impacts sales. But right now, it's just a lot of question marks. But all I know is right now, there's still a lot of leaks being spread. A lot of people are very upset with Naughty Dog, and that's not going to end anytime soon. It is also especially notable that nobody from this gaming industry has, I guess, held Naughty Dog or Sony accountable for their DMCA abuse and copyright striking anybody just talking about The Last of Us Part 2 leaks, which is something that I still find deeply concerning, and it just has not gotten enough attention. And that's where we are at this point, where I feel like a lot of this gaming industry is really focused on getting review copies and maintaining healthy and positive relationships with these publishers, and not addressing really important stories like I feel this was. But maybe that's one thing that I have an issue with previews like this. All of these gaming outlets, Game Informer, IGN, and such, they all get a preview of the game, but YouTubers and other content creators, I don't see anything from them, which is, I would say, a lot of the gaming audience is with those individuals, and I'd preferably want to hear their opinions rather than, say, IGN. At least that's just me, people. But at the end of the day, I think that's something that's gonna have to change, and it should. But circling back to what this really was all about, Sony's reaction to The Last of Us Part 2 saying no damage has been done, we don't really know that, and of course Sony's going to respond with, everything's perfect, pre-orders are up, this game's going to sell like hotcakes. But we really won't know if there's been any damage until those sales numbers come in a number of weeks and months afterwards. But if they are strong, I I think there's a very good chance that Sony, just a number of hours after the game has gone live, that we'll hear them flaunt those numbers and probably try to sway people in the direction of purchasing the game, because that's just that's how marketing and games work. So, yeah, The Last of Us Part 2's release is indeed quickly approaching, and I'm sure Naughty Dog just and Sony want this game out the door immediately. Probably yesterday they want this released, largely because the negative PR is not really slowing down at all. Now to our final story of the day, and that is on Cyberpunk 2077. So as most of you know, a couple of weeks ago, all of the various rating boards in the world, PEGI, ESRB, Australia's Classification Board, Brazil's, whatever it's called, they all gave details on what Cyberpunk 2077 includes, all of the mature content, and it's a laundry list. This game just has everything. And some of the ratings have, unfortunately, upset some organizations. And this was something that I expected. I remember the whole customize your junk. This was a joke that was going around, but a lot of people in the comment section of that video that I covered that were saying, watch the Karens get upset about this. And they were kind of right, but it wasn't actually a Karen. It was a Kathy. So if you don't know actually what's going on, Cyberpunk 2077's ratings, it's a very mature game. That's not something that's going to surprise anyone. It has a lot of adult content, adult romance, mutilation, lots of violence. This is kind of all what we all expected from CD Projekt Red, especially with what they gave us with The Witcher 3 Wild Hunt. And the only difference with Australia's classification of Cyberpunk 2077 is that it has high impact themes this time around, which I believe The Witcher 3 only had strong impact, but that's the only difference, at least in Australia's ratings of the game. Now, this brings us to the French-Canadian website, which this is the article called Video Game with All That Adult Content Arouses Outrage, and that's actually a funny title. But the piece begins saying that all of this adult content, the list of inappropriate content in the video game Cyberpunk 2077 is long, according to the Cyber Help Center. The organization challenges the Legault government and asks it to intervene before the release of the product scheduled for this fall. Cyberpunk 2077, as most of you know, will be releasing September 17th in Quebec on PC, PlayStation 4, and Xbox One. It's a role-playing game and has been rated M by the ESRB because of all of the various types of adult content that it features. And the Cyber Health Center, Kathy Tritault, which I believe she's the director general, she says, its content is completely inappropriate regardless of age. It's not the first nor the last game which will contain that type of content, but I think we must react. We do not have the right for our children to sit idly by. She added an open letter to the Prime Minister, but I will point out that this is not a game made for children, and this is on parents to decide if a child should be playing this, and I'm going to be honest, it doesn't sound like Cyberpunk 2077 should be something that maybe a bunch of 9 or 10 year olds who play Fortnite should be playing. That's just my opinion. Now, this article continues. According to the first images and information transmitted on Cyberpunk 2077, she believes that the game broadcasts images harmful to the that education of young people and to women's rights. That's a big assumption that she's making right there. And the next part says, educate the population. Kathy does not believe that restricting the game to those under 17 is sufficient. According to her, her organization and many others are trying to combat this type of inappropriate message. The director general reminded that this kind of game is detrimental to awareness-raising efforts. The content goes against what is acceptable, what we have to do at all times. And then she continues, we are entitled to wonder what sort of messages we want to convey to our young people. She believes that the Quebec government has the power to legislate. At some point, the content must also go with the actions. We try to educate the entire planet on aggression. I want to ask the government to legislate what goes into Quebec. Can we make recommendations? Do we have to demand a way to demonstrate that we are 18 years old? Can we say we don't want this game? She said in an interview with Radio Canada. And now she continues. She recalls that exposure as well as overexposure to hypersexualized or violent examples and models tend to desensitize our young people to trivialize that type of content. And then CD Projekt Red did not respond to comment for this interview. And she actually ended up following up because it sounds like she's trying to, I don't know if she's trying to say boycott or anything like that, but she wants some restrictions. She ended up following up saying that we repeat day after day on all the stands that we do not oppose games or on the internet. On the contrary, we want to get the best out of it by reducing the harms of the worst. She recalled wanting to send an awareness message to inform parents, which is what she overall wanted to do, but she clarified that she did not demand, request, or call to ban the game. She definitely wanted to clarify that because she knows how the internet internet would respond. And judging by people sending this to me, it seems like the internet's already like, this director general needs to back off a little bit. But to summarize my overall perspective on all of this, what it comes down to is just parenting. And you should be, or all parents should be, interacting or knowing what their child is actually doing or playing. And that's something that I will stand by. CD Projekt Red has been very, very vocal that this is going to be an adult game, and that's something that parents should definitely consider. And from my personal perspective, it doesn't sound like Cyberpunk 2077 is a game made for, or should be played by, you know, kids. And now, this director general, I'm not sure what she was trying to hit on. It sounded like she definitely wanted this game to be restricted in some sort of manner, at least that's what I got from this article based on the wording. But even then, I think parenting, I'm always very nervous about governments getting involved in gaming just because of restrictions and just overreach. That's why I was always skeptical about loot boxes and governments getting involved. But then again, the gaming industry just doesn't like to address its problems. They like to put band-aids on huge issues. And at this point, I just think this specific situation, parenting. When I was a kid, I was playing Grand Theft Auto 4, 5, San Andreas. I was watching in the living room with my parents, Alexander, and it was a sight to behold when Rosario Dawson's very nice body came on the screen and had a play fight with Colin Farrell. That was a defining moment when I was pretty young. I don't know why I still remember that to this day, but I do, and I think I turned out okay, at least I think. But I do take issue with one part of the specific article in which he says this game is going to be harmful to the education of young people and to women's rights. There's just so many assumptions made in this. The game has not been released. All she probably, or this director general, has actually read or seen of this game is what's been shown thus far, which isn't much on the overall contents of Cyberpunk 2077. And I think I can make a pretty good assumption as well that CD Projekt Red is going to handle difficult subjects with care. So overall, I think that this is a huge overreaction, personally something that I expected, but Cyberpunk 2077 adult game, something that, yeah, it's made for a mature audience, and there are teenagers, people under the age of 18, 17, that can definitely handle a game like Cyberpunk 2077, at least I think. At the end of the day, what matters most, it's not restricting, it's not banning or doing any of that, it's just called good parenting. Anyway, we discussed quite a bit of different gaming news today. It was a lengthy video. I definitely am enjoying this format, and hopefully you guys are, but let me know your thoughts, as usual, down in the comment section below on all the various subjects that we discussed today, but thank you for watching. Make sure to leave a like if you did enjoy this video or found any informative value, and make sure to follow my other social media accounts for updates on new videos. Links, as always, are down in the description below. I'm most active on Twitter, giving opinions on news that I do not always get into video form, so do make sure to follow me over there. Also, check out my Discord for all sorts of discussion on games. And again, thank you for joining. Consider subscribing for more videos like this, and I'll see you later.